All right, we will now proceed with the throwing of the things. Please throw the things.
There's a beverage involved. Throw this.
No, that's fine. Wait till it's empty.
All right, so a couple of quick announcements. Let's see. We have current year and prior year T-shirts available in red. So if you want a T-shirt, you should get them so we don't have to take them home and so that you can get the T-shirt you want.
Hey, Bob and I paid for this microphone.
And tonight the party is at 9 p.m. You enter from the terrace level and go down the stairs. There should be a crowd of people going that way. So to get to the party, please follow the crowd from the terrace level. And please do go down the other hallway at some point and visit the contests and events going on over there. So now for our talk, we have Anti-Ransomware Turning the Tables by G. Mark and Gall. So I'll get out of the way so they can do their thing. Give them a hand, warm welcome, please.
Well, hey, thanks a lot, and welcome back. And I guess we're all standing between you and what? Parties, dinner, booze? Only above. All right. Well, we can have some of that here, too. So, Gall Shpantzer, and I'm pleased to be here with you. Have a swig. Let's face it. Ransomware is pretty pervasive. Any quick survey here? Anybody, to protect your identities, know of somebody directly that has encountered ransomware? All right. Now, put your hand up if it was more than a year ago, like 2015 or earlier. So, it's huge. It's, wait a minute, huge. Got to work on my technique here. But in any case, what's happening is we're seeing a big surge in that. Published a paper through the SANS Institute in October looking at the financial industry, looking at some of the security risks, added ransomware this year for the first time. It debuted at number one. It was like one of the good old Beatles albums. You know, it comes out and bam, it's right there. So it's hitting a lot of folks, hitting a lot. And so let's take a little bit more look at it. So Larry King Lifestyle, perhaps, interviewing, I'm trying to figure out if you're John Lennon or, I don't know.
You've seen Fem Nikita?
Fem Nikita. I haven't seen Fem Nikita, so I don't have the reference point.
Victor Natoyer.
All right. So, all right. I'm saving that for retirement. So, Gall, seriously, in a scenario like this, who gets fired? I mean, isn't that really what we're worried about? Somebody clicks on something, they open up, and like, bam, things go bad.
A lot of this stuff is evolving, but the
use the microphone.
Yes, the main thing about ransomware that's different is that, in my mind, it's a CIO type of priority. If you don't have a CIO, and you're the IT person, and you also wear a security hat, you should be aware of this and understand that your SLAs and your various responsibilities for uptime, latency, productivity are what's being affected here, right? So this is a availability attack. So we have not seen clear delineation of who gets fired or who gets knocked down the food chain in terms of prestige and credibility in the corporation.
Use the microphone.
Yes. Oh.
Or sit over here. I won't bite.
I'm good. Basically, these roles are evolving. Ransomware is an availability attack. If you have an org chart that has a formal CIO, CISO, et cetera, then IT and security need to focus on this together, because at the end of the day, it's both a security issue, because there's malware and attackers involved, but it's really a CIO-level priority if enough of these devices get pwned, certainly on the server side, and then if it's bad enough, and I've worked on some places where it was, it's a DR-BCP issue, where the company's revenue and uptime and operations are actually a risk. So that's really the goal here, is if you get anything out of this today.
It's a long way of saying keep your resume up to date,
yes.
Okay? So anybody know if somebody's been fired because of ransomware? Yet? Yeah, okay, it's happening, and then the problem is that the biggest question of all is not who's responsible, who's gonna do it, but really, who's gonna buy the Bitcoin? Now, whose bright idea was this ransomware thing in the first place? Well, you're a lot more fun standing up rehearsing this. I'd say stand up, grab a mic, and you're a lot more at ease.
Seriously. In 1989, we had, look at that.
Yes. Dun, all right. Dun, dun, dun. All right.
Yeah. And I'm the other tall, skinny white guy here. All right.
Don't worry, he'll be back in a few minutes.
Is that a Police Academy reference? some of us are old enough to remember. So in 1989, the first known case of ransomware happened where someone had created a PC diskette that was infected with malware that changed file names and hid directories and required a payment of $189 sent to a PO box in Panama. So snail mail was the way to do it before cryptocurrencies were invented. Same general idea. And then somebody else in 1996 wrote a paper called Cryptovirology that said, hey, you're doing it wrong. You use symmetric key crypto. You should go with public key crypto. And that's, thanks, guys.
Yeah,
that's,
thanks, Columbia University. And, oh, by the way, I love, if you read that paper, their solution, access to cryptographic tools should be well controlled. All right.
You
only
the
let the government
were,
have crypto, and we will be safe. Thank you.
Good times.
But ransomware, really, I mean, it's a whole bunch of things. What?
Yeah, so in my mind, there's two types of ransomware. There's ransomware with the actual software, and there's ransomware with the ware, in scare quotes, where you're actually creating the availability attack without supposedly dealing with any malware at all. So we've seen, most recently, in early 2017, MongoDB, several tens of thousands of them, 30,000 or so with Shodan, had been taken over, deleted, copied, and requested money, requested a ransom. So that's not ransomware in terms of software, but it's a takeover, availability attack, denial of service on your stuff, and you get it back theoretically where there's money. Sometimes there's no encryption, usually there is. So I'm not here for definitional philosophy. The general idea is they get money after they take your stuff and deny you access to it.
Or basically, it's a really cool product where your customers call you with money. Yes. Hey, we'd like to buy. Okay, isn't that wonderful? I mean, no sale, no marketing or stuff like that. Your product sells itself. I mean, in a way, I mean, we get all these wonderful variants. Pick your favorite flavor. You never know what you're going to need next. But they all have something in common. They usually kind of catch you with that little kind of like, oh, oops, sorry, can't say it out loud, public audience, a feeling where you have that rather sinking feeling and you really wish you worked for NASA and were wearing Depends, because you're probably going to soil something when you realize that you've just screwed the pooch and your entire network, your systems, your files, your servers, as we're getting more into that, so it's going far beyond just your C drive. And man, talk about growth industry. I wish I were a venture capitalist. Investing in ransomware. Man, I mean, we'd be on Shark Tank. Dun, 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 dun. Hello, sharks.
Phone their laptops and they'll see that it works.
If you like your money back, you'll invest in me, okay? I've already pwned you. All right, so let's see what Mr. Wonderful has to say about that. But what we're seeing then is a huge surge in ransomware. You look at the FBI statistics. At the end of Q1 last year in 2016, they estimated approximately $250 million had been paid out in ransom. And so you just kind of linearly project that out through all last year. It's $1 billion. Isn't that right, Dr. Evil?
$1 billion.
Yes, he does the impersonations better. And so in any case, it's going to go up this year because it turns out that defenses aren't working all that well. So that's kind of why we put this talk together, to give us some ideas. I mean, why now?
The big question that's been circulating in the security industry on the blue team has been, what has brought this together? And the technology certainly is not new, it's just using malware, but I think what's happening is a big part of it is the glut of PII, EPHI, credit card, you name it, all the stuff that's been stolen from us 50 times over. We've all received dozens of these breach notification notices over the years. The fencing operation is not as lucrative as it used to be because there's just so much stuff that's been stolen and it's now more of a buyer's market. So I think that's a big impetus and part of that. You have to work hard to get to the point where you get the data. So if you look at on the right, there's the breach triangle from Richard Mogul from Securosis. There's an exploit. You have to get in there somehow, get in the network, find your way to the data, grab it, copy it, and then get it out of the network where the victim is, back to where you are, and you solely control it. With ransomware, you really don't need a lot of fancy exploits. There's not a lot of worming your way around to get to the data. A lot of that is automated, certainly on the client side stuff. And then there's no egress at all. Now, there are some cases where ransomware is the flashbang distraction device. They're actually going after your databases. That's true. But we're focusing on the stuff that is just the direct monetization of an availability attack.
So it's really kind of a change then from in the past where you'd steal something and then you go try to sell it on the black market. Right. So Target, for example, steal 40 million credit cards, 70 million customer records, And then, you know, the person who stole them, though, didn't try to cash them out. You don't see the guy backing a truck up to Walmart. Hey, I got some things to buy with credit cards. I'll be here for 2 years. You go ahead and you push them out into the field. But now you don't have to worry about that back end piece because, again, you only have one set of customers. The people who acquire your initial product are very happy to pay for it. So it's really try before you buy.
Yeah, if I roll a grenade into your data center and every little fragment hits a server and I get X Bitcoin per server, and you are feeling the urgency, then it is a lot easier attack cycle for me. And you know, I don't have to be as sophisticated, I don't have to be as sneaky. And again, if you're really good on the XFIL side and you've managed to block me, I really don't care because I'm not taking anything away.
Yeah. So ransomware isn't just monolithic. Originally, we kind of looked at the first kind where, yeah, something happened, you got on your hard drive, oops, there goes the C documents directory or things like that. Or now it's getting a little more sophistication. It's going after not just the dot the doc, XLS, PPT. We're seeing it going more and more. But then it really got interesting, didn't it, when it started to go ahead and spread laterally from an initial infection.
Right. So there's three major types of ransomware. The way I look at it is you have the client-side stuff. We're seeing it daily in our spam and email filters. All the Word docs and the poison links, poison PDFs, et cetera. That's coming in like PF2 carpet bombing on your endpoints. They're starting in the last X number of months and years to code in to the ransomware where just because they hit patient zero doesn't mean they're not able to automatically pivot into the rest of the network using various network protocols and stuff that we make it easy on them by using 1990s technology called file shares or map drives. Who here still has map drives and file shares in their environment?
Come on, right? Be honest. Who doesn't even realize you've got file shares in your environment?
The rest of you should make sure to proactively identify that because there's more of it than you think. It is quite shocking. Yeah. You go to Fortune 100, very large, very regulated places, we got file shares, it's still there.
And let me go one more. If you have somebody who's out there in the field and comes in through a VPN, this is one of the things I have not yet seen. By the way, I'm not trying to be Columbia University and give bad people bad ideas, okay? So don't share this. But how about something?
You who are watching and streaming, just don't.
Yeah, don't try this at home, okay? But the idea is you have some malware that gets onto a machine, and instead of encrypting, it looks instead for the presence of VPN client software, and it lays dormant until the VPN client software activates, at which point all the drive shares connect. Yeehaw! Okay, you just really increased your return on investment.
They're already starting to look for connections to databases, connections to VDI clients, so you might have an infected endpoint that is actually using a VDI client to get to the server side and browse the sensitive information. So there's all kinds of interesting things and innovative stuff to talk a little about in the future piece. But just because it hits the client side as the initial vector of infection doesn't mean that's where it's going to stop. And again, back to client-side ransomware, massive carpet bombing of usually weaponized docs or other documents in phishing emails. We also have the browser exploit kits targeting Flash and other things in the browser, just a little redirects, takes you to a website that is distributing stuff. Now, a lot of people in our field, let me get off on a little rant here, are always blaming the users for clicking things. Now, my thing is, it's our job and it's our responsibility to understand who our users are and what their role is and what they do for a living. So if you are in HR or if you are in finance, in many cases, unless we provide them the tools to do otherwise, their job is to literally click on attachments and links from random people that they have never talked to. You are recruiting people in DC, you're going to get a Word document from someone with a georgetown.edu address. How do you know that's actually a student there and not someone who took over their account and is sending you a resume? So our job to mitigate the blast radius. And if there's one thing that actually really matters in ransomware and other destructive attacks, is the blast radius mitigation on any given infection, and we'll get into that.
Yeah. So when you think about it, with these attachments and things like that, if things are coming in through documents or Excel spreadsheets or the like, best way to keep the dot docs and dot XLSs from blowing up, turn off
macros.
Macros, yeah, macros are the new four-letter word for 2017. And so the idea is that when did you ever really need a macro to get your job done in a Word document? Now, an Excel document, they're great when you get, especially it says executivesalaries.xls. Click here to see what the results are. Come on, HR doesn't do that with their own files. They're going to go ahead, it's phishing. But help people understand what's going on because people download stuff all the time. Server side, it's this is worse.
Server side is generally worse. You have a situation where people are doing the kind of full manual hacking. They start out using an exposed internet-facing server, usually with RDP, JBoss, other things like that. And what they're looking for is to get a foothold on the perimeter and then get in on the inside of that NIC and get to the data center to start doing the low and slow reconnaissance and enumeration. And they start creating a little public key for each server. In many cases, what they're doing is they're deliberately targeting the backup infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So if you're thoughts on ransomware is, again, those idiots who don't back up, you are necessary but not sufficient anymore because the backup needs to be re-engineered for malice and not just hazard. The vast majority of backup infrastructure is there to prevent things like we can't get copies of our data restored after, what, disk fail, power outage, and other hazards that have statistically relevant impact and frequency, and we have an RTO based on that. That is not the case with malice and ransomware. They're going to go after your backups, so be very aware of that.
Yeah, and on the server side, the big difference also is this is starting to look more like a traditional hack. You see, rather than just the drive-by where somebody clicks on something and boom, something bad happens, the server side, you figure, hey, wait a minute, if we can get in there, if we can understand what the target victim has in terms of file structures, drive shares, even who they are and how much are they worth, they're much more likely to be able to, A, get a lot more money for it, but B, then they're going to have more typical signs of infiltration and kind of going back through the old kill chain, which you'll talk about in a little bit, that we bring up, right?
Yes, I was at a client that got hit with server-side ransomware, and their IDS was properly configured. It alerted at the first sign of attack on a authentication bypass on the JBoss server, and the alert went to nowhere. And so weeks later, when their entire data center got locked up, and they knew about it because their telemetry went from green, green, green to red, 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 and they activated the ARC-BCP thinking there was a power outage or who knows what, it was ransomware.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of opportunities for the more traditional detection left to boom on the server side because it is manual hacking where they're going around doing the recon and the installation.
Now, I've also seen some instances where there's been sort of a power assist for ransomware. So I've had a couple clients in the last year who hit it, and they're both at the CEO level. One of them is a partner for a law firm. Another one was a CEO of a very large company. And I recorded one of the phone messages here. I'm going to play just a little bit of it to you, just to kind of let you know, does this sound like something that could be plausible in your organization?
Mark Hardy. This is Bob.
Bob. Okay, go on his name.
It's Thursday, May 5th. The time is 10 after 2, Buffalo time. I'm calling you because I think I've been scammed this morning. My computer was interfered with, and there was a message from Microsoft saying, call this number immediately.
You can see where this is going, but I don't have to pay you the rest of the
call. As well as other people, that virus will be spread around the world or something.
So here's somebody, very smart, very intelligent, attorney for over 50 years, who ends up falling victim to something that you and I would spot a million miles away. And that's the difficulty that we have. We've got to communicate effectively, both to our end users, not about, hey, blaming them, but they don't even understand the attack vector. They don't realize that this is something that represents a very rapidly emerging new threat, and it's going to really kind of create damages in an organization. Even things such as malvertising. Go to a Yahoo site, and what advertisers are doing, or the bad advertisers, they'll put in a legitimate ad, they'll go through all the screening, get posted up, and then what happens next? It gets substituted with an update that's not looked at. Usually gets a little pop-up player.setup.exe. Hey, that sounds like a reasonable thing to click on. Click here. And then again, in you go.
Shout out to Michael Tiffany from White Ops. He's here. That's their whole focus, is malvertising and creating a dent in that ecosystem of cybercrime.
You build malvertising, or? Oh, you prevent it. Okay. He profits from it. Hey, you know, merchants in the black arts.
I tried, Michael.
All right. No, he. Okay, so basically after people get infected, you sell them antidotes. I got it. I see. So you're an ambulance chaser in the digital age.
I thought I was a troll. Gmark's pretty bad.
Hey, this is why they don't let me speak only once every 4 or 5 years. I get out of control. So malware doesn't just show up. It basically has to get invited in. And therein lies the problem, is that most of the time, we build our network security infrastructures such that firewalls have primary rule. What's the prime directive for a firewall? No incoming traffic, right? And yet, typically, we invite this in, or it comes in through the mail servers, it comes in through a browser attachment, something like a JavaScript, and new ways of activating it. As a result, since they're coming right down the main track, coming in port 25 and port 80 and things like that, this is where all the other traffic is. You're not going to pick it out. It's not like the good old days where back orifice, port 31337. Hey, I could spot that port. That kind of looks a little bit unusual. That's not a normal Microsoft port. And Lockheed Martin hadn't trademarked that port number, so we could still use it. But anyway, yeah, special delivery. Here you go. So how do you deal with this? How do you help people understand that, and how do enterprises prevent this from happening? Why do they work? Hey, it's time for you to like interview me.
Yes. So why does ransomware work? And the GMARC has done some looking into why people think and interact with computers the way they do.
Yeah, so one of the things that often comes up is that you look at the human factors. All too often we get caught up as security professionals in the technology. And we recognize that the silicon in our network may be working just fine and be configured extremely well, but it's the carbon-based units that don't do so well. And as a result, it's the wetware that people are hacking. So people tend to be gullible, but also recognize that sometimes endpoint configurations are rarely correct. Network configurations aren't correct. The access control may not be correct. Backups may not be current. A lot of things have to go wrong for ransomware to go right, which kind of gives you the idea that why are people doing it? Anybody heard of Dr. Robert Cialdini, Arizona State? So great guy. He published a book several years ago about influence and what causes people to do things that someone else wants you to do. And he pointed out 6 primary reasons. Reciprocity. I hold the first door for you, you'll hold the second door for me. You buy me a shot, I'll buy you a shot. It also works at any level. Okay, I give you a free sample at a store and someone will give you, you buy the whole product because you feel socially obligated to it. Social proof, everybody else is doing it. Okay, this is why fashion trends kick on. I'm gonna have the same sneakers that everybody else has. Look at the idea of consistency. How would you feel if I said, you're very inconsistent? We almost take that as an insult. So we can appeal to that and try to get people to continuously do things they've been doing already. Liking, people buy from people they like. That's why salesmen are so smarmy. Authority, 4 out of 5 dentists surveyed want you to chew gum, right? That's sugar-free. Or when you get some of these ransomware things, it looks like a government logo. And scarcity, only 3 Shmoocon. Yeah, man, they got that thing down to a science. Okay, so enough said. Heidi gets mad enough as me as it is. I'm not going to pick on Heidi. But yeah, okay, so scarcity, only 3 tickets left, sale ends at midnight and things like that. So you can kind of map these things to ransomware and you find out, well, 5 out of 6 ain't bad. I'm not so sure about the liking part. But the rest of it, we realize also the consistency, and this is kind of a requirement that is put almost as a social peer pressure on the ransomware. You better make sure your stuff decrypts. Why? Because if everybody knows you pay, you get your files back, we'll pay. But as soon as somebody gets really fancy, says, hey, I'll take the money and I'm not going to decrypt, what's going to happen? It's going to break the trust, if there is such a thing, the whole trust in this ecosystem, it's going to crumble. And so there have been cases where early adopters had done dumb things, like they encrypted all the files and they encrypted the key encrypting key. Bad idea. All right, those folks, I think somebody dropped a JDAM on them or something like that. Or that guy in the video goes, have a nice day. All right, they took them out. So we don't see that ransomware anymore. Because this is like hundreds of millions of dollars, a massive amount of money. You can't afford to screw it up. So this is a success story. And it has nothing to do with grandfather, grandmother, whatever. This is just relaying the facts as they were. But my friend was working with somebody whose mom, she's a grandma, got ransomware. She had pictures of her dog and her grandkids and things like that. She couldn't get the files back. It's like, what am I going to do? This is horrible. And so she tries to help, but it's kind of a challenge. It's like a grandmother trying to buy Bitcoin is like a grandmother trying to buy heroin. All right? Where do you start? You know, where do you go and how do you get it? But daughter helped her get some of the Bitcoin together. But it's fairly volatile. I don't know if you've been tracking Bitcoin price. It's been up or down 42% since last week. It was up almost $1,100 last week. It's now down the 7s. And you know, it's porpoising all over the place. So by the time they got the money together, guess what happens? It's not worth enough. But that tick, 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 timer going down, they're almost out of time. So what do you do? they went ahead and they clicked on customer support. Click here. And they get a live operator. Okay? None of this. I'm sorry, our offices are only open from 8:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. Monday to Friday on Eastern Time. Please call back during working hours. They get somebody over there, and they say, hey, look, we got a problem. It's my mom. We're trying to get stuff together. We were supposed to get $200 in Bitcoin. It's only worth about $190. There's like 15 minutes left on the shot clock. Can you please, 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 please help? What do you think customer support said? Sure. Hey, some money's better than no money. Take a lesson from that, corporate America, okay? So there is a value in the consistency of being reliable, okay? So, because if you hear that every time you decrypt, you're going to decrypt, right? By the way, there's been some studies that have been done. They're in my footnotes to get copies of it. You'll find that. F-Secure did a study, tried to do a lot of negotiation with different ransomware groups. Found out on average you ask for a discount, you can often get it. It's about 29%, all right? So take that to CarMax and see how well that works. And they got a little table of it. They tell you, hey, if you get this family of ransomware, you're in good shape because they negotiate. They sometimes negotiate the price. They'll reduce more than once. They'll answer the phone and buy the third ring. And they speak English. And but it'll even extend the deadline sometimes if you're a little bit behind. You know, it's like a payday loan in Bitcoin. Okay, fine. Yeah, we'll give you a little bit of time to get stuff back. Some of them, though, at the one on the bottom, Torrin Locker, you're out of luck. That's like unattended, like nobody answers. And remember when Tesla crypt? They changed their algorithm last year. And then they went ahead and one of the researchers said, hey guys, since you're no longer doing this, why don't you just give me the master key? And he did. They gave him the master key. So and basically the message said, here's the master key, go ahead, someone else. And they went to their website when you got things, someone else is gonna write a decrypt tool. They got out of that. It was not worth sustaining an older version of an operating system, so to speak. So for all you people still running XP, take note, all right? They've even moved on. So MedStar, what happened there?
Yeah. If you live in the DC area, which is some of you doing this, you're here in Shmoocon, there's a big healthcare group called MedStar Health around here, and they're about a $10 billion a year revenue. So you know, pretty big, successful place with a bunch of hospitals and a couple hundred clinics. They got ransomware in end of March 2016, and they put out a little announcement saying there has been some computer downtime. And that was March 29th, early Monday morning. Coincidental, early Monday morning is when everybody gets back to work, and computer downtime. So significant progress is being made toward restoring functionality. What is that? Does that sound like a CISO problem, restoring functionality? Who at the end of the day is responsible for restoring functionality? Oh, wow, okay. And they made a decision to take down all of our systems as a precaution. So they pulled the big switch. CISO doesn't always do that, even if there's malware around.
Now, I'd heard the story, maybe you confirm or can deny it, or maybe someone else knows the answer, that because a lot of these things are opportunistic, they kind of got notices, hey, you got to pay a Bitcoin. And someone went back and says, dude, you know, like, we're a hospital. We do good for other people. Please, why would you hurt somebody that does good? Oh, you're a hospital? It'll be 25 Bitcoin now. I was in San Francisco last month when the San Francisco Muni got locked up. And I was out there teaching for SANS, and I found out that the first day could have rode for free because they didn't have any way to collect money. And they had to leave the operations up and running. They didn't want to stop the trains because of the impact on the people. So they just said, okay, I guess you just go through the turnstile and pretend you're in New York instead of San Francisco. I don't know. And enjoy a free ride. But what came out of that was the same thing. Fairly high ransom, but on the server side. So the question is, what about principles? Well, we never negotiate with terrorists. We're not going to negotiate. Well, screw principles. That's how that transliterates. Which costs more, your principles or the ransom? But that's the wrong question, isn't it?
I believe that people who are on the record moralizing and philosophizing about funding cybercrime should hang out with people who've been victimized by this stuff and their data centers locked up. MedStar had to postpone, delay, and change venues for surgeries. This is not a time to discuss high moral values. It's a time to restore functionality and then deal with lessons learned later. Now, a lot of people say, oh, we didn't pay the ransom, we didn't do this. I'm not here to judge you. If your network's locked up, the last thing I care about is giving some incremental $10,000 to a $1 billion, multi-billion dollar cybercrime industry. Your focus should be how to get functionality back to your network.
And that's even the wrong answer, the perspective. What's it costing me per hour to be down? Who cares about how much money they have or whatever? Okay, so go ahead and join a ransomware support group. Hi, my name's Mark, I got ransomware. Hello, Mark, okay? So the point is, just do it. You gotta get up and running, and if that's what it costs, that's what it costs. Okay.
One more thing about MedStar. By Friday, they were up to 90% restored functionality. So imagine a $10 billion conglomerate, 200 clinics, 10 major hospitals with people flying in here from all over the world to get exotic new procedures. And a week has gone by, including paper documentation. They're up to 90%. I met someone from MedStar off the record in 2016, and they said that they had not restored full functionality for about 5 weeks. So again, that is not the CISO's fault, okay? You gotta look at someone else way above that is gonna be dealing with lawyers and regulators for a while. And they're gonna be feeling the pain.
The lawsuits that come out of things like that. I felt really bad putting crosshairs on nine kittens, but you know, we had to talk about killing nines here. But we didn't pull the trigger. We paid the ransom. Yes, sir.
Isn't that why the CIO has a CISO?
Is that why the CIO has a CISO? Ask Target. Well, they got one now, but... as CSO, usually, chief scapegoat officer, right? Isn't that what the S stands for? Something goes wrong, you get blamed. Okay, you get fired. Okay, they never come with a retirement plan because no one's ever lived that long.
If you're in security, you need to find a way to communicate about ransomware to the business ownership and the people who own uptime, disaster recovery.
So it's like having that conversation with your teenager. Yeah, but so they've been doing porn for years, so don't worry about it.
You will... be on the hook for what is today a very easily foreseeable circumstance. It's not a random, kind of exotic, rare thing. It's not Stuxnet coming into your network. It's just ransomware, and you need to figure out how to get control of it.
So what do you do? Well, the IBM X-Force, trademarked, I got to say that. Okay, the registered trademark of the X-Force. Hey, these looks like pretty straight things. And this is actually the words that come out of my words are in parentheses because it didn't always make sense with things. But you can download the presentation. It's on page 29 or something like that. But in general, they're kind of focusing primarily on a single vector here. They're kind of looking pretty much at email or browser. Well, okay, two vectors. But in general, what we're finding out is a lot of what they're doing is trying to take the user out of the launch sequence because if our technology does what it's supposed to do, malware doesn't go off by itself. It usually requires somebody to be duped into press here, open here, click on dancing bears, do one of those things, and as a result, it's by roping that human in. So one of the low-hanging fruits that a lot of the vendors think that we can do is, well, let's just get smarter people. Okay, but as we all know, I love that DEF CON shirt, and social engineering specialist on the back, it says what? Because there's no patch for human stupidity. And so there always will be markets for this. So kind of like the fight crime, shoot back idea, can we do anti-ransomware? And this is kind of where we're getting to the fun part of the conversation now, the second half of the talk. So what do we do?
One of the things, obviously, is understand that you can reduce the number of clicks to any given campaign by education. I happen to think education is necessary, but nowhere near sufficient, even for client-side stuff. So understand that with exploit kits, there is zero human interaction. These drive-bys and malvertising, they don't have to click on anything. They merely have to automatically render a piece of flash in the browser, and that's it. Their computer, if undefended properly, is gone. So user awareness training is helpful for all the things that G-Mark talked about that are relating to the psychology of the carbon-based technology, and we're now at the point where, okay, we've reduced the click rate, there's less crap coming in and being acted upon by the people. What about all the automated stuff? My opinion, and this is going to change and evolve because it's always an arms race, in the past 2 years, the next 3, 6 months, whatever, this is on the low end of the totem pole in terms of sophistication and ability to execute against hardened environments. So you want to get yourself to a point where ransomware, in my mind, is if you cannot defeat ransomware to the point where it's not a catastrophic issue after someone clicked or got pwned, then you got a lot of re-architecture to do. One of the easy things to do, and it's free out there, ransomware tracker on abuse.ch, get some basic threat intelligence, free feeds, sort them by distribution sites.
You're 14 slides ahead. Let's catch up with your brilliant brain here. So, first of all, Lockheed Martin. We're talking about going on the offense, right? A little bit different. All right, Lockheed Martin, their cyber kill chain, you got to call them, give them a quarter unless you give them credit for it because it's trademarked, right? Registered trademark, reconnaissance, weaponized delivery, exploitation, installation, command and control, and actions on objectives. Okay, so somebody went to basic school in the military in the last 150 years, and they just kind of translate over in the cyber world. But if you think about it, here's the assertion. Remember the old security model that, wait, we have to guard all the entrances to our network, but the attacker only has to find one to get in. Therefore, it's an asymmetric, and we're on the wrong side. This suggests that there's a whole chain of events that an attacker has to complete effectively, and if we can disrupt them along that chain and before they get to the end, we can win. You can stop it on a goal line defense. It might have driven 99 yards, but no touchdown if you hold them on fourth down at the goal line. And so that is a new way of thinking it. And because cyber kill chain is trademarked, and a lot of people forget that, here's some spares. Just in case, you can borrow one of mine, take it out of the presentation, drop it in yours. It was already published before yours. You can claim prior art and you're okay. The thought police won't come after you. But it's a numbers game to a large extent. These are not yet organized that I've seen into deliberate campaigns. But I think that's going to be coming next because a lot of that money that's ransomed is not just going in to going ahead and buying booze and hookers. It's also going into going ahead and develop better software, better techniques, more research. And quite honestly, there are places in the world that don't quite like us. Well, let's face it. And so as a result, hey, you can go ahead and work in a research lab, or you can get paid a lot better to do some research and develop malware, and it happens like that. And so it's a significant infrastructure. If you said, hey, I want to run my own ransomware service, I want to do the whole thing, you want to be vertically integrated, okay, there's your MBA term. So what do you have to do? There's a lot that goes on. You have to be able to find exploits, develop software, obfuscate the malware so you can go ahead and get it past all the sensors to get it in there. You need some good communications interface and get this thing on and potentially high bandwidth and also be able to resist distributed denial of service attacks against your competitors who might try to knock you out of the table. What else we got? Website hacking tools, email spamming bots, crypto key management. Yeah, go ahead and take the crypto course again because you want to make sure you don't screw that up. Thank you, Columbia, for the idea about using public key. That's a whole lot more efficient. And monetization, you have to go ahead and get a Bitcoin wallet and then be able to move money around. But the thing is that once you get it into there, you have to kind of obfuscate it a little bit because you don't want to have tainted coin. Because if you don't understand much about Bitcoin, understand it's really just a gigantic transaction register. And every transaction can be traced to the prior, to the prior, to the prior. And so you could say, hey, I paid ransom on this day. And by the way, any fruit of that transaction is quote unquote tainted. It's kind of like the banks where they go ahead and they put the ink on the money that's stolen. You could still accept a $100 bill with a big blotch of ink on it, but someone else is going to call you out a little bit later downstream. And then, of course, money laundering, because you want to get it out of Bitcoin, because with extreme volatility, January 3rd, $1,125 for Bitcoin, now down in the high 800s, was in the low 700 or high 700s. And it's moving all over the place. And quite honestly, not too many merchants around the corner are going to take Bitcoin just yet. So where do you disrupt? If you thought about it as an attacker, not as an attacker maliciously, but as an attacker going on the offense against the bad guys, there's a whole bunch of things that could be disrupted. If you can do this, we're kind of modeling the kill chain, recognizing that there are some things we could disrupt that might be a little bit too late. Yeah, we could go ahead if you could quote-unquote poison their transaction with Bitcoin. Not quite sure how to do that yet, although I did have a talk on cool stuff on Bitcoin, but this one, the one that got accepted. So I was going to do the other one with Satoshi Nakamoto, but he couldn't make it. And money laundering, can we do something about that? The customer support, maybe we shut them down. But that doesn't really help because the problem's already done. So let's think a little bit about server-side ransomware. And at that level, which Gal was talking about as being a little bit more extreme, that's an entirely different animal, isn't it?
It is, again, compared to the client-side stuff, or even the hybrid, where you have a client-side that then moves to the payroll server because it's map drive or file share. Server-side is actual hacking. It's manual. There's a whole supply chain to it. They're going to buy scanned, exposed RDP or JBoss or whatever, and then start hacking it, or even they buy pre-hacked servers and then buy that access and start from there going in, starting to enumerate, see what's going on, find your storage area network, find your network attached storage, whatever it is that you're working on, that has again been designed for what? Who's been paying attention? Hazard versus malice.
Yeah.
Okay. And so.
And it's still three slides away.
Still three slides away. Very good. I'm skipping ahead. You're looking for ability to interrupt and detect before they actually detonate the ransomware. And that's what your goal is. So again, you can find the authentication bypass on JBoss with an IDS or other things on the server. You can find the lateral movement, which almost nobody does. Who here has the ability to detect lateral movement inside your data center? So I got your JBoss server, and I want to get to your backup server. Can you find me sneaking around in your data center as I'm trying to do that? Who here has that and is confident they'll find that?
Yeah.
Almost one guy.
Well, wait, we need a control group. Who here is willing to raise their hand? All right, so it's not as bad as you think.
Yeah.
But here's kind of a sea change in terms of reporting. Health and Human Services this past summer issued a ruling that said if you have protected health information, what we call PHI, and it is subjected to ransomware, this event is now reportable as a breach. The logic goes if they had write access, they must have had read access. And it's possible they could have exfiltrated it. Now, the interesting thing is that one could reasonably argue, hey, according to my logs, yeah, we saw something bad come in. We never saw our stuff go back out. Now, that's a judgment call that requires a C-level decision. Are you going to thumb your nose at the regulations of the United States government and say, we're not going to report because we're pretty sure it didn't happen? Now, if it never got to your PHI, because as we had seen in some of our clients that we've helped out, where it was stopped before it got to that location, we're good. But the danger is, what if it actually got there? You've got a business decision to make, and that's going to be well over the head of the CISO or the CIO.
The thing with the HHS ruling is interesting. I think we'll see that go to other sectors. They came out in July 2016, if you want to Google for the PDF, July 2016 HHS ransomware guidance. And they have four different pieces of proof that you have to supply that end up at the end of that showing a low probability that the ransomware touched your stuff, mm-hmm. The EPHI, and managed to munge it. So the idea there is, ironically, because ransomware, again, in my mind, is a fairly low bar in terms of sophistication and ability to access hardened networks, if you got pwned with ransomware in a significant way, the chance of you being so well instrumented and able to get that stuff out and analyze it and create the determination, the chance of those are fairly low. So what's going to happen is you're going to bring in a consulting firm and they're going to camp out and run up a lot of bills through a law firm, which runs up more bills and creates more friction. So the idea here is, again, put some basic defense in place, mm-hmm. prevention, less stuff happens, mitigation, each server or laptop that gets infected has less of an impact, mostly through compartmentalizing, segregating, and segmenting your network.
Sounding like my friend Eric Cole, prevention is essential, you know, important, but
yes.
Detection is a must because you're not going to get 100% record. You're not going to stop them all. Well, here's some of the resources you were telling me about. Okay, so you can go ahead and you can actually download DNS lists of things, ways that I can prevent it, so that if I know the whole list of IP addresses, the names of the URLs and things like that, can I do something about that in DNS?
We can. How many people know how many top-level domains are there total now?
All the GTLDs.
5,000? What?
That sounds like a good Hacker Jeopardy question for the summer. Study up, kids.
There's over 1,500. 1,500 TLDs. So there are a lot of them are throwaway domains, and that's a list to actually download the text. It's automatically updated in real time. You'd be shocked, as I was, when you see how many TLDs there are. And when you go to your folks who run DNS, ask them, do you have these in any sort of black, gray, or white listing? Yeah. For client side and server side. Is there any reason why your AD server should be talking to .sucks or .hair?
Yeah. Or .xyz. I mean, here's a packet capture, and we're actually looking at the traffic, and it's very rare that you're actually seeing it to a register.com. It's going to go to one of the generic top-level domains, primarily because they don't have the same accountability. They usually say, you know, get it now, and you can pay for it in 3 or 5 days. Well, they never end up paying for it. It's kind of a flash domain. It's there for a little while. You do your malware, and then you're done with it. And as a result, it's a cost control measure. MBAs would love that, wouldn't they? Yes, sir.
So since the servers only need to be there a few hours late,
because you can block an IP address very, very quickly globally by just telling everybody, don't go to 1.2.3.4. But with DNS, because you can go ahead and allow that to move around, you can have your DNS change fairly quickly. And so instead of getting the time to live in your DNS record of being 3,600 or like 3 days, you can make it 2 minutes. And so as a result, what you're going to have is a DNS that continually changes on the lookup. You never know that looking at exfil, because attackers have been using that traditionally to obfuscate that. Hey, I've got 1,000 outbound packets to 1,000 places. But if you look at the DNS records and you look at the matchup of the resolution of a particular URL, you'd find out that is a problem. I ran out of whiskey. I can't wait. I need a shot. I'm out. So say yes to DNS filtering. All these DNS TLDs, the CC TLDs, country code, generic TLDs, some country codes are more popular than others. But is there even a good business reason to leave these things open? Isn't most 98, 99% done to .com, .net, .org, .gov, .mil? Yeah,
I've had some good success basically telling people, hey, I'm going to do some things with some top-level domains. Let me know if you're going to have a problem. And you know, you can kill .ly, but also whitelist bit.ly, right? You can kill PO and whitelist WAPO, or kill MS and whitelist NYTMS. Yeah. So those shorteners out there. This is kind of like tuning a IPS, where you get some iterative approach. Mm-hmm. But certainly on the server side, there is very little use case for your servers going anywhere but very specific domains.
All right, so let's bring it home in the last 5 minutes here. We can block communications by going ahead, and you can look at ransomware, sorry, my eyesight's going. Tracker.abuse.ch, and again, all these will be in the notes and get copies of the slides. Email defenses, you can filter before at the email server. You're looking primarily for attachments. You want to make sure things like .js, JavaScript. You know, we're talking about like who clicks on .js? Apparently a lot of people do. You can put them in a zip file. It's like, how do you weaponize a zip file? Because people open it, then click on stuff. It's like, really, toy surprise inside. It blows up. Okay, let's see what's in it. Rewriting the links to spoofed emails if the resend to and the reply, except the problem is that it could mess you up with the scan to email and copiers and things like that. Virtualizing your applications, using something like Invincia to go ahead and put a wrapper on your browser so the thing's operating its own kind of virtual container. So if something blows up, it kind of stays inside that container and it doesn't get through your stuff. There are places, if you do get ransom, you can go ahead and upload your samples. Say, hey, I think I got pwned. What do you think? And they may say, yeah, you got pwned, but you're lucky, because this was an older version of the Tesla crypt, and we've got the master key, and someone wrote a decryptor, and here you go. And so these are kind of the good hygiene factors, if you will, on the network, where there's people out there on the internet really working actively to help out. So let's kind of wrap it up here. Client side, what do you think? 30 seconds, 60 sure. seconds max for the next two slides.
All the malware detection and prevention mechanisms that work for regular malware that's out there to steal your stuff, they are applicable in some way to ransomware, except that the time to detect is not as important, because chance of you detecting it in minutes or seconds is very low, even if you have like a super SOC analysis team on the back end running your campaign analysis, because this is, again, rolling a grenade into your LAN through your clients. So looking at have people make less decisions on less crapware at the email server or before the email server, so pre-email server, email server, client. Yeah. If you find the case where you got pwned, and make sure your backups are robust, keep them offline. What I like to recommend is if you don't have a super sophisticated backup system, get the backups that you need. Put them up in S3 and then expire them to a Glacier and disconnect from there. And you have the access to that is only through kind of a privileged admin workstation that's in a special zone that is not online and is protected and hardened. It's only used for that purpose for DRBCP. Migrate off the freaking map drives. It's 2017. Please, please, please don't do that. I've dealt with too
segment,
many people.
Segment.
Yes, segment time segment. Other fun stuff, if you have local admin passwords that are entirely the same throughout your LAN, that's a problem. I consider that a part of segmentation because it's the exact same thing, MS laps, things like that.
So kind of a response strategy. If you're going to go ahead, and these are the checklists to go through, which say, hey, what are the questions we need to ask? To whom do we need to inform? What are ways that we can respond? So ransomware in general, you want to kind of look if we can claw back, figure out what's going on, get things that are offline, the backups if we can. determine what's the delta between the last known backup and the time that we have the current. You might make a business decision that is less expensive to go ahead and just roll back to the last update and then recreate during that last cycle. Or you might just go ahead and pay the ransom. Of course, the problem with paying the ransom is you're just kind of feeding the enemy. And so from a philosophical perspective, that's always kind of a bad idea. And of course, lessons learned are very useful. We want to capture those. You know, what got pwned and how badly and where are our backups and what were the exploit kit? We got to make sure we have a notification strategy. Run a dry run or two with your CISO, with your CIO, with your CEO, and your board. Say, this is a drill, this is a drill. Ransomware, ransomware, ransomware and server, 1.4. Whatever, and then figure out what you're going to do with it. And so as a result, you'll find out that, like Admiral Rickover had said, anyone who stops to think in the middle of a crisis shows a severe lack of training. You want to go ahead and practice it so you've got some known response. On the server side, how badly is it? How many are locked up? What's the impact of it? Is there a backup function intact? Can we get together with legal or something like that? Remember, a lot of these things can be negotiated down. They might not negotiate to zero, but depending if you're willing to go ahead and get in there and mess a little bit. And please, by all means, don't say you're important. Say you're, I'm
just an 82-year-old grandfather and I don't know what to do. And I'm living on a pension. Will you take a couple Satoshis and give it a try? You know, the worst they could do is put back the thing, but don't tell them you're important or they're gonna kick the ransom up and you're gonna have to pay a whole lot more. So, billion last year, no reason to suspect it's going to get any better. For every dollar spent on ransom.
The first week of MongoDB pain, 100 terabyte, 30,000 Mongo databases went away.
Yeah.
Again, is it ransomware or ransomware? Whatever, they got pwned. So that's authentication in addition to anti-malware defense. But yeah, they're going to get inventive. They want your money. They're going to attack you for your availability, and you're going to pay them unless you have the ability to instantly restore.
And so it's already a billion-dollar business. Biggest danger is not having a good backup, making a lot of money for the bad guys. And so we're going to finish right on the numbers here. That's anti-ransomware. We're going to stick around for some questions, but I'll honor the 50-minute block that we have for the presentation.
It's the last presentation, so we can hang out.
We can hang out.
We got
adult
some
beverages.
Good stuff.
We can call out for pizza. I got a gentleman in the back. First hand up. Yes, sir. Speak loudly. Oh, thank you. Doctor? Okay, yes, sir.
I was just going to say the most effective mechanism I've seen so far is through policy. And it changes the font.
Yes. Yeah, so gentleman mentioned using group policy to show extensions on attachments because you have a .doc that is actually a .doc.exe or other things like that. Is that what you're saying? Yes, redirects the various scripts and other functionality in the attachments to a safe location. Yes.
What's the what?
The modern replacement to using mapped drives.
Box.com, Google Docs.
Really?
Literally, yeah. Is there something? No? Bueller? Sure. SharePoint. Okay. Yeah. Like not actually $$share, right? I would venture to say that Box.com is a lot more secure than a lot of the map drives I've replaced, and I can prove that by saying, you know what? I had an incident where someone moved a folder, and they had to launch a 5-day investigation. Where Box.com, all they had to do was have the person say, what do you think moved? And they went in and saw that the thing was moved by the right person.
One, two.
Yes. Yes. So I haven't done statistical analysis on kind of phishability and click rates on client side after ransomware. What I'm focusing more on is are the executives who hold the purse strings and the air cover for authority to change stuff, like the CIO, they are extremely, extremely effectively convinced when their land gets blown up, and certainly when their data center gets blown up and their SLAs go through the floor. There's a utility, BWL, they paid a little bit of a ransom, but they paid $2 million for the response. They over-responded. This is a really huge
problem actually with over-responding by just throwing a lot of kitchen sink stuff at it that hasn't been integrated or thought through, where they have three different antivirus engines on all the boxes. It's crazy. So I think I can't answer your question directly. I would say the best I can tell you is it is a very, very convincing scenario that your data center is gone.
Next, please.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So CryptoDrop behavioral use the file.
Entropy.
And, yeah. And also magic numbers to identify, you can pretty much find existing ransomware attacks within about 10 files.
Yeah, and if I were doing that, what I do is I would seed a whole bunch of dummy.docs, XLSs, things like that, wire them for sound, and then figure out that statistically it's going to run and bump into one of your booby trap files, at which point find the process, PS kill it, and disconnect from the network and start a whole bunch of remediation. I don't see any reason why you can't do that. Anyone want to go on Shark Tank unless somebody already beat us to it?
What's the name of the tool? What is the name of the tool you mentioned?
It is a product?
It is a product.
All right.
Somebody tried to sell it to us a while back.
Didn't you buy it?
No.
Okay, well buy mine. Okay, I'm a better salesman. I bring whiskey. And someone else pays for it. I got to make someone else pay for the whiskey, right? No, we've heard that.
One of our clients actually saw a CPU spike. The bad stuff came in through RDP over the internet to the server side. They were there doing troubleshooting and stuff like that on various processes, and they saw a CPU spike on one of the servers. They thought something really bad's going on. They ran in, and they disconnected the cable to the core switch. So physically, that's not an optimal scenario, but it worked in this case.
Pulling the plug.
Literally pulled the plug.
With CFS, like checkpointing every 15 minutes.
Sure. Yeah. Again, ransomware is evolving, but currently I think it's not the hardest thing to stop. And certainly to mitigate is actually a little bit more difficult than prevention in many cases because of lateral movement.
Is there a community that is actively working on the decryption strategies?
Yes.
Yeah, community actively working on the decryption strategies.
The no more ransom.
Yeah, no more ransom and things like that. The difficulty is this. If you do your crypto correctly, and I teach crypto, and I'm kind of a crypto mathematician by trade. I don't consult to the bad guys, so I'm not going to tell them how to do it right. But if they did do it right, what you're going to have then is a generation of a key pair where one of the keys is never, ever going to leave the malware server back in .r wherever, and the other one is going to get transmitted there. Now you're going after traditional, very heavy-duty encryption. Now, typically what I do is I'd use that key pair generation to then go ahead and create something. AES-256 is the fastest way to do it because symmetric cryptography runs thousands of times faster than asymmetric cryptography. But in terms of generating the key pair, the key that I use to generate it is going to be protected or armored, if you will, by that asymmetric key. So short of somebody making a little mistake or an error, it's quite possible that you're going to be guessing in order of 1 to the 256 power if you're going to try to do it the hard way. And the computing power required to do that is always going to be less than whatever the ransom is.
Sometimes that is the case. What they're doing is... So the gentleman asked, sometimes you can see on the network, you can see a key coming, and I've seen PCAPs where a client goes to a Russian server, grabs a key, you can see the whole conversation.
Yeah.
The problem with that is that they're innovating and they're creating less C2 because they know that's a mechanism for us to detect and block that communication, and so then you have malware that has no ability to encrypt, which is kind of beyond, not the point there.
And they're using the native Windows crypto libraries to go ahead and do that, lock it up, and then when you get locked up, they may not have a copy of the master key. It's encrypted, heavily obfuscated on your machine. And again, the effort required to unravel that would take a lot more money and time and effort than it would be to just that. Now, because when it phones home, it's going to probably already use a pre-shared key with the ransomware server to transmit the key encrypting key or the encrypting key for the files back up to the mothership. Or if you want to do that entirely without transmitting cryptography, and again, I don't know how they designed this, but I'm trying to think of how you'd solve this problem if I were one of the bad guys, working with the crypto library on the machine, lock the thing up using the native crypto libraries, present the thing to the customer for ransomware, go on up there, and because you've already got some pre-shared values or keys, once you paid your ransom, it's been validated in the blockchain that actually got paid, then the server is going to kick back a value which fundamentally combines with that. And it could be something as simple at that point as 256 bits and you just XOR it with some field on your machine. That's as tiny as you need to get, and then boom, 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 your ransomware could already have the decryptor built in.
So back to the future of ransomware, they're doing those things to prevent some of the extra communication and detection possibilities. They're also getting to the point where they're not allowing us to do repair as much as possible. Mm-hmm. So in some cases, they're killing the ability to boot into a safe mode. So again, this is an arms race. It's malware. In this case, they're looking at an availability attack. But all of these things are being tested in real time, and it's going to get better and better for them, worse and worse for us.
Okay, number one, two, three, four. One. Ransomware? I asked the CIA.
Who wants a polonium cocktail?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think governments need to invest in it. It's possible we do, but the problem with ransomware is it's primarily, when you look at CINA, is an availability attack. It's not against confidentiality. It's rarely, it's sort of, but not quite against integrity. A lot of what you look at the government international level is confidentiality. How do we steal and grab things from other nations? Now, if you got to the point where you wanted to actually lock them up, for example, we're going to go ahead and do an airstrike, so we're going to lock up their air search radars. Most of those things aren't running on IP-based systems that are using Windows files. God help you if your national defense system is running on Windows. But
like some of our destroyers?
Yeah, most of them are going to be running on their own custom systems. Number two. Pick the most important one, because I can come back to you as number five for your second question. How many keys do they use for the files? Some of them use the same key for all files. We've also seen when they get ransomware going across an enterprise that it's going to pick a different key for different servers, but those are often the ones where there's somebody actually in there working with it. It's possible, not necessary, but it's possible to have a different key for every single file. Typically what happens, though, is that many of them will do a goodwill gesture of showing you, pick one file, and we'll decrypt it for you just to prove that we can. And so that's built into some of these ransomware things, but you wouldn't work that effectively if you had a different key for everybody. Are we running out of time?
5 minutes.
5 minutes left. Okay, so let me come back over here to somebody that said it was number three. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to know, when you watch the
Yes, so are the attacks a manual attack, an automated attack, or a hybrid attack? What have we seen? Typically, the initial infections, when we're talking about the client side, are going to be primarily targets of opportunity. Typically, it's going to be somebody doing a spamming campaign where there's going to be a lot of malvertising. I've seen some estimates that suggest north of 85% of the spam messages today contain links to sites that are going to go ahead and push ransomware or attachments that will start ransomware. That's a phenomenally huge number. We no longer have somebody trying to go ahead and scam you out of your money by putting in a credit card to buy little blue pills that never show up, or they end up being sugar pills. But the way this works is it has to scale, and it scales through automation. And with $1 billion of success in automated distribution, I don't see a good business reason to go get a whole room, a boiler room full of people doing manual stuff. The manual stuff is the enterprise-grade attacks. That's when you know you've got somebody really big on the line, and then you bring in your tier two support, if you will, to go ahead and really put together a big attack. Who did I say was number four? Was that you? Okay, just say social engineering, you win, and then... No, they just put it all into a CD. Well, the problem with the permissions, it depends upon what you get. If you're in there as a root on a Linux box, if you're in there as a sysadmin, you get around a lot of the file permissions. One way, to, another way to do it, another here, if someone wants to go to Shark Tank with me, we just go ahead and we change all the .docs to .qzws and not the XYs, you know, XLs things to something else, then go ahead and change that in Windows because you can change whatever the reference is when you go into File Explorer. And then ransomware says, man, there's nothing here. By the way, there's some interesting stuff. I don't know if you caught the previous talk. I missed it because we were kind of tuning up our slides, the one that was talking about Cuckoo. But I've heard that some of the variants of ransomware will actually go ahead and look for most recent files because Windows will keep track of that. And if there are no recent files that were accessed, it concludes it's on a virtual machine. It's a trap. And it doesn't deploy, it doesn't activate, it doesn't go back to the command and control or the mothership. And as a result, it basically remains dormant. So one potential thing, always run on a virtual machine and don't save any of your files. Not terribly useful. Sound like 1970. Yes, sir. Backups are usually for disaster, yeah. Yeah, backup strategies. One of the key things is this, is that as we've seen the ransomware evolve, it's taking a look for drive shares and also connections. If you go ahead and disconnect a drive share, it'll try to reconnect it. Because if you go ahead, you know, do a net use at the command line, you can see disconnect, disconnect, disconnect. You can reattach them just with that information. So one of the things I recommend, I stuck it in one of the slides, I might have gone by too quickly. Always ensure that all of your drive share connects, anything for backups in particular, but anything in general requires a password. Even if it's password. The reason being is that a lot of the malware is going to try to say, hey, let me try to reconnect all shared drives. Okay, let me reconnect that thing. What's the password? Geez, it doesn't know, and it's not worth trying to figure it out. So it's the same thing in some cases where any password is better than none because they're looking for no passwords. So that's one possible remediation that might help. There's potentially others. Yes, sir. Yeah, they're out of business soon, though. But the problem with insurance is you don't have good. You need actuarial data, number one. You also have to have a large risk pool. And what you do is with the actuarial data, you're able to price the thing effectively. With a large risk pool, the law of large numbers helps you because having a lot of people go bad at a time is now 4, 5, 6 sigma away. You're one in a million. And when you get catastrophic events, you just put those in exclusions, such as nuclear war or zombie apocalypse. And then as a result, you can always make money, which is why Warren Buffett bought Geico. You can't lose money if you do it right. So I don't know of anybody who's doing insurance for it. There is one company I do know of that does offer a guarantee. It's called KnowBe4, K-N-O-W-B-E-4, number4.com. Stu Showerman runs this out of Clearwater, Florida. Stu and I have met, he's a friend of mine. And what he does is he says, if you purchase our awareness training for your employees and they click on ransomware and they get locked up, I'll pay the Bitcoin ransom. It's in the guarantee is in there. Okay, number one,
we have
number
to,
two.
We're getting evacuated. We're going to go over there, and let's hang out just outside the room. They got to turn over the room.
Bring adult beverages. We'll talk all night.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much. Yes, please exit stage right. I love this. All the guys are grabbing a card. She grabs the booze. I said, women in computing, absolutely, you guys rock. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it. I'm the same guy, so if you take two cards, someone won't get one. I have two companies, so. Yeah, if you grab two cards, share one with someone who doesn't have one, because it's still me. I just have a couple businesses. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, no, no, no. I was just telling him. It's like I have more booze I can drink.